So we're going to ask Norvin to start the recording. Good afternoon, everyone. Once again, it is a pleasure to be here with you. I want to introduce our guest speaker for this afternoon. Her name is Paula Brenes. She is an IT engineer. She has a college degree in IT with an emphasis on software development. She holds a master's degree in information technologies and project management from the Latin American University of Science and Technology in Costa Rica. She also has a graduate degree in digital transformation and is currently doing postgraduate work in digital marketing at the International Institute of Marketing. Currently, she is a member of the board of directors of the Association of IT and Computer Professionals in Costa Rica. She is a board member of the Inter-American Digital Committee and a member of the user group, the IT user group, and director. And a member, she has worked for different entities in the government, the private sector, and academia, and is supporting initiatives that foster gender digital gap reduction in different areas. From on the coordinating team here at ICA, we want to thank her from sincerely for having taken the time to be with us. She's been very committed and had a high sense of responsibility to prepare this presentation, to talk to you, to be here for you, and share some of her knowledge and experience on these subjects. We will wind up our mentorship lectures, and it's one of the most important one for helping you develop your proposals. Thank you, Paula, for being with us. The floor is yours. Thank you and good afternoon. It's a pleasure for me to be here with you today. I will see how things work out with my audio. Why are we talking about value propositions in these projects? All projects should do that, as a matter of fact. Whenever you want, the value proposition includes a few concepts that will sound like the business world to you. And the fact of the matter is, we should do this for every project we want to launch. I'm going to share you a presentation with you, and we will send it, and I'll send it to you afterward. And I can take questions from you if you note them down on the chat line here in Zoom, so you don't have to wait until the end. In any case, we will have time at the end for questions that I haven't addressed yet. Priscilla, is that all right? Yes, that is fine. Good, thank you. You already were able to attend a presentation on design thinking, and I want to use that as a basis for what I'm going to present today. We've been talking about the five steps: empathize, define, ideate, prototype, and evaluate. Empathizing will be easy for you on these projects you're developing. And so in this session, we're going to start talking more about defining. You do this before you ideate and far before you do a prototype. It's important, therefore, to focus on this part of the process. This is a term that you see a lot in marketing. It's called the buyer persona. And as you will see, it applies very well to many areas of life. I don't know if you have heard this term before. At the end of this session, you will say, oh, is that what it's all about? I know what that is. I knew what it was, but I never knew what it was called. So let's focus on the buyer persona. There is a particular way to learn. There's one way to learn to drive, which is to sit down in the car and start driving it. I don't sit down and say, Priscilla, you're going to learn how to drive. You need to read this book, learn how the car works, learn how the motor works, learn how the accelerator works. No, I sit Priscilla down in the car and I say, drive the car. And she says it stalled. And I say, start it again. It didn't go out right. Try again. And the same thing is true for the buyer persona. The buyer persona tells us what the profiles are that we want to appeal to, or to whom we will be offering something, a product perhaps, a service. These names, by the way, are fictitious. These aren't real people, but we might say, I'm going to use a combination, Manuel Zúñiga Brenes. That's my person. Strictly fictional. These are common names and we can put them together and make a person. Another way to define the buyer persona, for example, where I work, we use superheroes to name our buyers. But these are names we're all familiar with. So when you see a profile, you say, oh, here comes the Heidelman, and you know who Heidelman is and what Heidelman is like, and we know what service or product this person will want to buy. These are templates, and they have links that you're welcome to use. But the most important thing is to know what this template has in it. So I want to talk more about the buyer. This is nothing more than a representative of our ideal customer. We want to know this person. We want to know who our customer is. We want to know how this person shops. We want to know what it is that you are going to introduce to this person, whether it's a platform or a service or a software or an app. Who are we doing this platform for? Maybe right now I'm designing a platform with a web idea or with the idea of a website, something. Or it's an app, and we call this person a customer, but just to call it something. But the fact is, you have heard these people called users as well. Sometimes they call them buyers, but it's all the same. It's all the same idea. It doesn't matter what you call them. The important thing is to define this person clearly, because that will be the basis on which you can design a strategy, focusing on meeting the needs of this person. Just to get to know the person better. Because if I want to go out to 1,000 people, I won't be able to know who they all are one by one. So instead I create a segment, a role, a type of person, a persona, that's what we call it. So I can get to know this person, so I will know how to communicate with this person correctly and offer this person only what this particular user group or this customer needs. Why do I do this? Because our focus is not on the product. The first mistake, and starting now, you will be using this term, we are customer centric. In the middle of everything we do is the user, is the customer. Before, in earlier time, it was all about the product and everything revolved around the product. But that's over. We don't do that anymore. Now we talk about being customer centric. It's very important. Remember, you know how they say that the customer is always right? Well, that's the customer, the user. That's the most important part of the whole equation. So from here on out, that's who I create for. I don't come up with a product and say, I'm going to invent this product and figure out if anybody ever wants it. Instead, I say, I have this user. What problems does this user have? What problems do the customer have? So I can help solve it. Now, if I know what this person needs, what this person wants, what fears this person has, what are the motivations? Great, then I can come up with something that this person needs because I have figured out who this person is. If I knew this person perfectly, then I would take all that information and put it to use in order to provide this person what he or she wants. Maybe you are working on teams, so you might even have a representation of all these profiles. What I've always suggested, for example, I have always needed a taxi service that will pick me up at the door at my house. How about you? No, I'm more concerned about how much they'll charge. Well, what about you? No, I've always needed to know what route they're going to take. We all have desires and preferences for our taxi. So I take all those needs and desires and use them to create a proposal. I don't do it backwards. I don't come up with a product and figure out who can use it. So that's why we do this persona, this buyer, to get to know this person. And then I ask Priscilla, what are your needs? What are your transportation needs? Priscilla, what are your transportation fears? Oh, she might say, it scares me because these taxi drivers are unknown to me. I don't know where they're from. But maybe on the telephone, I can have a picture or a profile. So that's a solution we can provide. What would motivate you? What are you motivated by? No. For me, motivation is price. For me, motivation is peace of mind because I know the route. Listen to these problems and listen to these ideas that Priscilla might have or the needs she expresses. You're already familiar with transportation platforms such as Uber, for example. So you say, here's the answer. Well, in order to do that, I need to know this person. We can't be groping in the dark. We can't be certain that we're doing things right if we do not know who we're doing it for. If I'm going to give someone a benefit, but based on my own needs, then I've got it wrong, because the product isn't the most important thing. It's the customer, and technology is for the benefit of the people. It's very likely that our product or our service or our app is not for everyone. No, we don't do a product or a service for everyone. Instead, we do it in order to solve a specific problem, in this case for rural young people. And there might be a certain population that's not interested in the product or service, but another group will be interested. And not only do we benefit them, but how do we benefit them? So it's so important to define who is going to use this product, who needs it, what do they need, and how will they use it? Just a voice of caution. You can have various buyer personas, and they will all respond to different needs. You don't need just one. For example, you might think about a product, and you will say, I'm going to use it for codes. We can speak in code for this particular persona. Say Bob Sponge, Sponge Pants. And so we can say, well, who will be Patricio? Patricio is that person who's always angry and bitter. Well, so who was our Bob Spongehead customer? The one who's always friendly, always having fun, doesn't care if things go wrong. How about who is the squirrel, Chip? This is the one who's always trying to find mistakes. They complain, but they point out all of the problems. They're waiting for someone to help. So start thinking about the characteristics of your users based on some character, fictional character that we're all familiar with. So you might say, Priscilla, we're having a problem with the Arenita characters. Well, she understands because it's based on a television program. She's familiar with the program. She knows the character and she knows who I'm talking about. We can have a number of buyer personas, but the important thing is to decide what each one wants, what they need, what encourages them to use the platform. As I said at the beginning, there are several critical words here that come from the business world. And they don't necessarily need to be for buying. What we want to know is who will use it. Are you satisfied with it? Are you happy with using it? Yes. Well, that means they're using it. So if it leads, in the business world, this leads to a purchase. In our case, it leads to use. I love this picture because the fact is that no matter how much we want to, on this picture, you can't see the faces of all the people who will use your platform, even if they put it in their profile. Or because memes don't always look back like the real person. Imagine that you're familiar with the photograph of these users, but you need to know what they're like. What do they need? So the most important thing is to develop empathy. Maybe I live in Panama, for example, but I want to put myself in the shoes of someone who's in Ecuador. What's the weather like? What's the altitude like? What's the setting like? How is the pandemic affecting them? I put myself in this person's shoes of a friend who is in Ecuador, so I can offer a solution to a need. Maybe you will find that what they need, that my friend in Ecuador needs the very same thing that my friend in Colombia needs, but I'm in Panama. And as it happens, all three of us are in the same buyer persona, the same profile. If you take time ahead of time, before you sit down to develop a solution or make a prototype, Einstein used to say that if you had an hour to solve a problem, you would spend 50 minutes investigating the problem, and then you could solve it in 10 minutes. Do that. Before you try to develop something, develop this buyer. Ask, what does this person want? What does this person need? What would make this person happy or satisfied? What can I do to make this person recommend my platform to someone else? For example, I use a number of apps on my phone. It's kind of like a hobby. I love apps, and if I find one that I fall in love with, I recommend it to everyone. I tell everyone about it. And I'm looking for them. And I say, why is this one better than that one? If we're that critical with our own apps, how much more so should we be with a platform that can help us? Because what we want is for them to recommend us to others. So having said that, let's get down to work. We're going to give you some templates, but it's important to start off with demographic data. How old is this person? I'm going to start to write a profile, okay? My profile is young people, boys for now, we'll do girls later. These are 16 to 20 year old boys. That's my buyer. And the profile is Bob Sponge Pants. Where does the person live? Central America. We don't know exactly what part of Central America. What about the social class? Why it is important to know the social class? Because I need to give them what they need. And I need to think about this person's environment, surroundings. What does he like? What does he get excited about? What's he worried about? I can think, for example, income. Does he have internet, or does he have to use prepaid? Well, how much education does he have? Why? Because maybe he needs the buttons or the icons on the platform to be big with icons, pictures. Because if we write it out, maybe he would get confused. We don't know how much education he has. We can think about his professional situation. What other personal factors should I consider? What do you do in your spare time? Nothing right now because we're all locked up because of the pandemic. Yes, but if there were no pandemic, what would you be doing? Go to the movies. He loves the movies, for example. And if you can't go to the movies, then what do you do? Well, what needs are still unmet? What are his main abilities? What would he most like it to do at this time? Work, get a job. So that's one of his main needs. What about challenges? What are his greatest challenges? To stay in school and keep working. I'm making this up as I go. I'm thinking about Bob Sponge Pants. As you know, he works at a hamburger stand. And how do you associate that with one of our users? A user of our app or our platform that we will be developing. What's a typical day like in this person's life? What motivations does this person have? What does this person want afterward? And what's preventing him from meeting his own goals? Maybe the solution I'm going to give him, in fact, responds to his needs, and he will say, this is what I always wanted. And what are his buying habits like, his shopping habits? We were talking, I hope some of these tips and this presentation will also help you tomorrow if you want to start your own business and you need to monetize your application or the development that you will be doing. What does this person consume often? Hamburgers. And where does he get his hamburgers? Where does he eat them? What time? And why does he go there? It doesn't matter. Or does he take them home, or does he eat them on site, or does he eat them on site because it's closer, or does he eat on site because it's cheaper that way? Why does he eat on site? What questions does he ask before making a purchase? This hamburger, or maybe I want fries, or maybe I want a Coke. What else do I eat? I put that all in the... Maybe he's a little bit overweight, and so he decides not to take the fries, or maybe he's concerned about health. No, just weight, so that's more of a social thing. All these questions. And we're taking a clear interest in this person who will be using our product. How does this person behave online? Why? Why do I want to know that? Because what you will be developing is being developed in the digital world. Now we need to forget about the newspapers, or for example, now we can talk about encyclopedias. Remember those that we used to use? Those big thick books, that the Encyclopedia Britannica, for example. It was expensive, it was enormous, and 2 years later it was out of date because the information had changed. Imagine a world without digital. But today we live in a digital world, and so we need to ask different questions. We have to ask, what is the online behavior of this person? What characteristics does Bob SpongePants have? Say we have Priscilla in Panama and Paula in Nicaragua and is using many of the same things. Well, maybe we could find out if we're including this the social media by country in order to figure out on what social media are used by Priscilla and Paula and Manuel, and leads all of them to use my app if I know what they do online. And Priscilla doesn't use Facebook, say, because she thinks it's old-fashioned, it's for old people. But she uses Instagram. Those are questions I have to ask and remind her that I have a very good app here, and remind your old young people such as Priscilla that they can use it and know how to advertise it. What do you like better? The text, images, podcasts, or do you love videos? Maybe you live, eat, and drink videos. Do you do everything on your cell phone, or do you also use a computer? Mobile data are too expensive. I don't have enough. I don't even understand how the computer works. Which do you use more? Oh, I definitely computer, because I use it for school. I use it for my work, selling hamburgers, but I don't really have time to be doing anything else. So you may say, where am I going to get all that information? If you had time to carry out an in-depth study, a population study, you could use a focus group, get them all together, talk, ask questions, or you could conduct a survey. You could use online tools such as Google Forms, and in order to contact all of your Facebook friends, and I've got this survey, please everyone answer it for me, I'm in a hurry. Or I could send a WhatsApp message by chain or broadcast and ask everyone I know to fill out the form for me. You are a working team. You can divide it up. You can say, I want everyone to bring 20 surveys so we can put together our buyer persona. If you have a project that's already up and running, or if it's something for the future, and you want to do this to figure out what users you're actually reaching, then you can use statistics from Facebook, you can use analytical figures from the social media, you can use all the information on Google Analytics, you can use internet to ask people who already are using the service about their use. For you, it's not the case, but in the future, you might be interested in knowing. This is how you do it. Once you have this information, you have your survey, you asked your questions, then what we do is we draw up an empathy map. What does Bob SpongePants think? What does he want? What does he believe? These are the same questions we asked before. But here we're graphing them out. We're plotting them out into a graph. So we need to draw the empathy mat for Bob SpongePants. We need one for Sandy. We need one for Patrick, and for all of the characters. Maybe the young women I work with, or what, as Priscilla was saying, now we're working a lot. Right now we're working a lot with the people in technology. Out of all 100 students, 28 are girls, for example. So we have four buyer personas here. One is a girl and the rest are boys. And this gives us a representative idea, a proportional idea of what this girl represents. What's she worried about? What does she care about? Because her concerns are very different from those of the boys. And she's particularly concerned. It's different. For example, you may, a student who works is different from a student who only studies. Or the same is true for you. Maybe the concerns of a friend from Ecuador might be the same as those of Panama, but not the same as Colombia. So this empathy map helps you take all that information and group it together in a square, in one box. Be careful. This is a critical point. Do not focus on the product. I already said that, but you're already picturing what it will look like. You even know what color it will be, but get that out of your head. Forget all about your app. Forget about your platform. Forget about what you're going to develop. Set it aside. Stop along the way and start thinking about people. What I'm doing, what I'm making here, does it help a user? How will it make the user feel, for example? What are the user's perceptions of this product? It's boring. Why would I ever use it? What? Another app? Are you kidding me? My cell phone has no more capacity. Forget it. I'm not going to install another app. Why not? Because this person is concerned about the capacity and they want to have pictures instead of apps. So what's important to this person? Be open to criticism. Share everything with everyone. So you have all that information. Imagine. Before you do anything, take a few minutes to imagine, to think about crazy things if necessary, and see what you can develop. This is an example of a template of a buyer persona. Name, age, location, education. It's all the same. It's the same template, but it's a different way of portraying it. It's a different shape. So now we're sharing it better. And behind it here, we have the links to all the options for the templates for the buyer persona. Once I have that, then now it's time to develop what I'm going to develop. I know the needs, I know the concerns, I know the fears of my users. So with all of that information, what do I do? What is a value proposition? Well, first of all, less is more. You need to summarize as much as you possibly can and stay pragmatic. So to summarize the first definition, we can say that a value proposition is whatever shows the potential user what it is that you can do for them. This is the value that you lend to others by solving a need that they have. So in order to solve someone's need, first I need to know what their needs are and that needs that can be solved. I'm going to give you an example. Think about a newspaper, a print newspaper. The biggest newspaper, New York Times. People aren't buying newspapers anymore. The trend is to consume less paper. Also, I buy a newspaper in the morning and by afternoon it's out of date. And so they're losing subscribers. I'm going to leave that on the table for you to think about. Think about how a newspaper can reinvent itself and increase its sales in today's world. I don't know that when the last time was that I had a paper newspaper in my hands, but the problem still exists for us as users. What is our problem? What is it we not? What do I want and need to find out what's going on? I want to stay up to date with what's happening in my country, in my region, in my neighborhood. What isn't it a value proposition? What it is not? It's important to understand what a value proposition is not. Some of the mistakes you see, they're very common. One is to say, it's a slogan, a motto. That's not a value proposition. Yes, you need to be brief, but what gives value? It's a differential proposal. It's something that very often you want to say sometimes you want to say, I'm different for this reason. This is why I'm different. But that's not a value proposition. So what if you're different? It's not my professional activity. It's not my degree. It's not my CV. I'm an advertiser, say. I'm a publicist. I'm an expert in digital marketing. What's a value proposition for a digital meteorologist, for example, or a marketer? Helps you sell, helps you get to more customers, helps you increase your sales margins, your positioning. That is a value proposition. It's not my degree. It's not my documentation. It's what can I do to help you? What is it we want? We want to bring together a proposal of something I did and get it in the hands of a customer, of a segment of customers. Say we go to a car distributorship. So Priscilla comes in and she wants a car. So I pull out this car and I say, Priscilla, this is exactly what you're looking for. I've got the answer. Four wheels, four tires, two doors, six windows, and a skylight that opens and closes. And Priscilla says, what are you talking about? All cars have that. That's not what I need. Ah, then I can say, before I offer a car, I can ask her what she needs, right? I spend my time in meetings, she will say. I'm always driving back and forth. The streets are in terrible condition. Parking is impossible. I need a car that's small, easy to park. I'm usually by myself. I don't need a lot of space. Or maybe Manuel will say, well, what I need is a family car. I've always got the kids in the car. We go everywhere together. We do our shopping. We do everything together, the whole family in the car. I need something bigger. Someone else will say, no, I'm Casanova. I need a red convertible that goes fast. So that's the value proposition. An engine. It's what are my needs and how can I meet them? Let me tell you, people don't really buy cars anymore, do they? Keep that in mind. Now they use other strategies. So there's also that. Why do we need a value proposition? Imagine that you are working on this project. You work 3-4 months on a project. Work hard, get it out to the market. And in the end, it comes out and it's not what people wanted. It's not what people needed. So what do? This is why you do a value proposition, to be sure what segment you want to sell it to, what this person needs. It's a unique proposal. Well, what makes it unique? We'll be talking about that in a moment when we fill out the table. Does it help me with something specific, or is it out in the ether somewhere? I love this slide. It's an infograph, what they call it. And it's things that could happen. If you do a model, if you don't do a model for your business, you will improvise. You will take longer. You will spend money. You will waste opportunities. It will be chaos, in summary. We can't do that. We can't afford to do that. Every time we come up with an idea or need to do a project, we will take the time to start it right. Enough time, whatever it takes, to develop a canvas. A canvas is like a painting. That's not the right. That's almost like a template, a poster. And I can fill it all out. I have some examples for you. I fill it all out and it's divided up into two sections. On the right, we have the customer segments. What do you fill that out with? With all the information we came up with on the buyer persona. On the left, at least on my left, we have the value proposition. This is what I want to offer these people. There's a gift wrapped package in the middle because that's what I'm offering. And the next one, and on the right, we have a little face. So I'm going to talk about each one of these items. The customer profile has a section on customer work. These are functional things. It could be a specific task. The person wants to eat, for example. That's a task. It could be something social. This person wants to make a good impression, wants to have status, wants to get supporters because this person is political. There's also the emotional side. They want to see people at this time when it's so difficult, or maybe they have other emotional needs. They want to feel satisfied. They want to help others. It all depends on the context, right? You can't leave the context out. Once you have that list of tasks, then you set priorities. You rank them from the most important to the least important. Priscilla, what's the most important thing for you out of this list? Well, for me, what's most important is to eat a healthy diet, because that is what gives me the energy. I will feel better when I eat badly. I have a headache and so forth. So this particular quality that we put into our buyer persona will also be ranked by importance. The next one is frustrations. This is a very valuable opportunity because if we can help people with their frustrations, we will be doing them a big favor. It's a good service. For example, it could be unhappiness at work. They've got a problem at work, or maybe it's side effects. Maybe they have trouble with undesired problems. Even it could be, or just because it's too boring. And they say, what I want to do is eat a healthy diet and have a healthier body. But it's such a bore going to the gym. It's such a bore to be all by myself out there. They make me walk on a treadmill and I walk and I have nothing to do. I feel stupid. Take notes, write it down. What are your barriers? I never have enough time. I get up early, I go to bed late. I don't have time to go to the gym. Why don't you have time to go to the gym? Is it a problem of this or is it resources? What are the risks? If I don't go to the gym, then it doesn't matter how well I eat. My body will still need exercise. So we take note, we write down all these frustrations, and we rank them from the most extreme to the most moderate. What are the worst difficulties and what are the least? The next one is, what are your joys? Your happiness. That's the best part. I like that. This is the best one. For example, I can say, how much joy does it give you to have a telephone? Well, it's critical for me. It's essential because that way I can make phone calls. Okay, that's a joy. That's a necessary joy. It's a minimum. It's something you need. You need to make phone calls. So we can call you on that. That's when we used to use phones just to make phone calls, but now that's the least thing we do. How about an expected joy? When the touch options come out on telephones. And then after a while, you get used to that particular anticipated joy at the very least. How about a desired joy? We would love to have integration with other products. And how about an unexpected joy? Like Ratatouille in the movie, remember? The critic says to the chef, surprise me. How can you surprise this customer? What would be an unexpected joy for the user of your app? At some point, Apple invited developers to offer apps for others to use. And at some point, we found ourselves facing an enormous range of possible apps. And after that, the other developers started to do the same thing. And it became an unexpected joy. The other extreme, the other side of the equation, what do we offer? We need to map out a list of everything that we will be offering, physical or tangible, or maybe it's digital, or we could think that, come up with some crazy ideas. Everything counts, everything is good. What if the person has been with us on the platform for a number of months and we send a gift, a physical gift, an actual gift, we send it to them? The person receives something unexpected, an extra, a box. And in that box, they find a positive message that says, you can do it. We're working together. We're a community of rural young people. And here's a sticker for the computer, something physical that you can offer. Or if necessary, down here, we may talk about how we can deal with the frustrations that the person has described. How can we cope with them? Kids, we're not going to come up with a crystal ball here. We're not going to solve the whole world's problems. No, one problem, one frustration that's affecting one person. This is why this map, this canvas is so important. We use it for different buyer personas, one for each one. Because SpongeBob SquarePants does not have the same problems as Sandy. So we can focus on just one group of people and do a canvas specifically for that person. And of course, the creators of joy. How can I make the difference? Why is my platform different from someone else's platform? Why is my solution different from someone else's solution? Maybe Priscilla's. What does mine have that's different? Why should you use mine? What does mine do for you? And if you focus in on this, you will see that this map is like a mirror, a mirror image. You have the customer's needs and what the product offers. And frustrations, relief from frustration, the joy, the creator of joy, the work, the products and services. And you can write it out on, you can put it on the wall, put it on a poster, put it on a computer, but write it down, get it in front of you and set up this mirror image, the person's needs and frustrations versus what you can offer. The technical word we use here is a fit. If we can develop a fit between the two, then eureka, you have found a good proposal that's worth passing along into a prototype. Here are some keywords for you to take with you when you fill this out and how you fit one to the other, how you connect them. This is a template, as I said before. There are others. This is very simple, very practical, very specific. And here's some other examples you can look at. These are some simulations. For example, this is someone who does it with post-it notes for planning an activity. This is another way to do it. This one is someone who wants to set up a website. Who's it for? It's for a travel website, for example. A zero limit, it's called Travels Without Limits. Travel Without Limits, that's the name of their website. And there are 8 keys that you can see. This is a good infographic, by the way, because it has good suggestions for your value proposition. I can't explain to someone what a platform does or what an app does clearly. And that means I've got a problem. If I can't explain it clearly, then it's not good. I need to have a clear understanding and a clear way of explaining so that they understand what it is my app can do. Sometimes we want science fiction. We love science fiction, but that's not what we need here. Here we need reality. You need to have your feet on the ground. List the benefits. What benefits does this give you? Quickly, tell me one thing that makes it different from the others. Why is it better? Why is it unique? What's different about it? Because mine respects the rights. Mine protects user safety, user security. It keeps you safe. If you want to go into it a little bit more, you can look into A/B tests. These are tests to determine what most affects a user. The information is there if you want to look into it. It needs to be possible. It's something you need to be able to read in 5 seconds. That's how fast it has to be. Here are 7 words of advice for designing it. There is some of these are reiterate what we already said, but these are the most important thing. But the most important thing is to combine the customer's need with your proposal. That's the most important thing, fit them together. And this is the book. It talks about designing the value proposition. You can look it up. Keep it in your library. I think it's a good investment for you to make. It will last you the rest of your life. It's that useful. And finally, I want to close by saying that I hope you can think of something disruptive, something different. How How, for example, how can newspapers, how does the largest newspaper survive? What changes can it make in order to stay relevant? What apps can it offer to its users? That's good. And be a place where the news is different. That's another one they can do. Create subscription processes so that people will want to continue receiving the content that you have to offer. What about the encyclopedia that I told you about, the Encyclopedia Britannica? What disruptive technology came along? The Encyclopedia Britannica changed its market. Now they sell to schools, teachers. They have a lot of material and content. They have options for evaluations and tests, just like quizzes. It's a support resource for education. It's also a change that I described before. The product is not the important thing, but the person is. And they did something disruptive. If you can do something disruptive, something different, remember that you need three things. If you want to be disruptive, you need easy access. It needs to be easy to access and use. It needs to be supported by digital technology, which is what you're doing. And it's something that people can afford. It has to be affordable. Disruptive would be a trip to the moon, right? Let's go. Great, but who can afford that? These are some examples of businesses, of disruptive businesses in the digital age. I already talked about taxi services. There's also the hotel industry, which needs to reinvent itself because of the pandemic. Maybe you don't know this story, but before Netflix existed, it was common to rent movies. You needed to go out to the store and rent a movie, a video or a DVD, and then you had to return it when you were finished. And if it was late, if you missed the deadline, you had to pay a fine and so forth. Then there's Slack, which is competing with email. And even education has changed now. This completes my presentation, and I think we still have a few minutes for questions. Thank you, Paula. Because this is a good way to wrap up our discussion about how our participants will be formulating the hemispheric community of rural youth. Now I want to ask Manuel whether we've received any questions on Menti. We set up a Menti for questions. Listeners, we can also use the chat line on Zoom if you want to ask questions of Paula. On Menti, we don't have any questions yet, but I want to remind you that the code is 40949784094978. While you're working out your questions, I want to focus on the idea that with this last image we saw, what needs to be disruptive. I want to talk about that because in addition to the whole, the fact that this is one of the criteria for your proposal. How can you create this idea of a hemispheric community and make it something different? We've talked about a number of tools, design thinking. We've talked about what defining the problem, then design thinking. Then we also talked about how you can develop this hemispheric community, make it sustainable over time, how it should work in terms of governance, how you can cover the greatest diversity. And today, this morning, we were reviewing the case of a very practical case of the 4-H clubs in Canada and what they have done to make all these things happen. All these technical tools we have became sustainable. How they set up networks, how the mechanisms they use, the areas where they work. And now with Paula, we would be wrapping up this proposal by saying before you come up with a product, first you need to figure out what you want to do with it. You need to put a face on your users. Who are the people that you will be offering this proposal to? Imagine the members of this hemispheric community. So you can develop profiles and reach as much of this community as possible. Manuel, do we have questions? Also Ileana and Manu, Norvin, and you're all part of the team. So if you have questions to ask or anything you want to add to this, you're welcome to do so. Nothing yet. Is there anything you would like to add? No, not at this point. We do have a question on the chat line of Zoom. It says, it's from Juan David, and he says, in the case of the canvas, could you give us some advice about the brand, the trademark, and how we develop it for our community? Yes, at the end, the trademark, the brand, reflects a profile. It responds to a profile of a person or various people that you want to reach. So for example, I want to give you an example without influencing your own innovations. So let me come up with, and when you find this, your solution, and it's different, there's something different about it, it's unique, you find it, which makes, what makes you different. That's what you will use as inspiration for your brand, because your platform will be different from other platforms. You have this and they don't. So when you find it, that thing, then the keywords that you use, those are the keywords you use for your brand. But on the canvas, you don't put a brand suggestions, because that's not what the canvas is for. The canvas is to ask, what am I doing for whom? What does my platform do that makes it different and better? And if you answer that question, you will discover a brand, a specific clear brand name. Right now, as Priscilla was saying, we are thinking about people, targets, who they are. And then after that, you think about the product. If you start off thinking about a product, I want to do something disruptive. So let's do a product. That's backwards. Your purpose is not to disrupt. Your purpose is to meet a need that someone has. I want you to do something to help this person. That's how you find solutions. If you think about Netflix, for example, oh, what a drag going out to the store all the time. I get wet, it's raining, and then I watch the movie, I have to take it back, it's a problem. So think about that problem that the person has. And that's when you start to disrupt. What about Uber? I had trouble with taxis. So they started talking about the problems people had and they came up with a disruptive solution. And the same is true for all those other examples. So don't start with the product. Start with the person and figure out how you can help that person. When you find that distinguishing value, then you will easily find the brand. Thank you, Paula. Laura says, more than a question, I would just like to thank Paula for your presentation. It was very clear and dynamic, and it's evident that you put it together with great passion. Thank you, Paula. Thank you, Paula. And this is from the EquiCert team. It's a pleasure. It's a pleasure. I hope I was able to share what I'm thinking. All of this is what we call co-creation and knowledge. And later on, if you share it with someone else when you're solving a problem. Focus on people. In businesses, they say customer-centric, but I don't want to use too much business language here. But remember that technology is nothing but a means to achieve an end. So I hope you can share it with others to make this a better world, of course. Thank you. Juan David says, do you think it would be feasible to solve three problems, or is it better to go after just one? That's interesting. I think it has to do with streamlining business processes. Very, very often we come up with one solution to one problem, but we start adding more to it and adding more to it. Cell phones. First of all, they gave us an option of sending text messages. Then they added a camera. Then they added this and they added that. It's all cumulative. Personally, Engineers are there to solve problems. That's what computers are all about. So I tackle one problem. If I just do one problem or project at a time, then nothing comes of it. But then there's an iteration and I add more to it. I improve it. I change it. I know that we're taught not to make mistakes, but the best thing that can happen is to make, if I'm going to make a mistake, make it fast and change fast and improve it. So I would suggest that you read a little bit about agility. There are some books about it. And I can share you some, I can share some titles with you on the platform. And development methodologies. There's also a framework, a working framework called Scrum, and that's good too. Thank you very much. I would like to add a little bit and remind you that over the course of this whole process, we have seen a number of different types of problems affecting the communities of rural youth. It's important to focus now on a proposal for a hemisphere-wide community that can coordinate all these needs, bring them all together, so that we can drive development and abilities for the people in this community. And so we need proposals and suggestions through joint work, teamwork. So remember that. And especially because of the comment that we just received. Manuel, is there anything else from Menti? No, nothing further on Menti, no. I think the chat line was used most. It doesn't matter. If there are no further questions on the chat line, Paula, then I would just like to thank you so much. As I said at the beginning, for the hard work, the sacrifice it took for you to be with us today on a Friday afternoon. It's a complicated time and we know that everyone's worried about their health. You need to be resting, but you're here with us today instead. So thank you so much for that. And above all, thank you for sharing all these ideas with us. Unquestionably, we have closed with the best possible presentation. I think with what you said, our kids can take the weekend to come up with some very good proposals, exciting sound proposals, so we can put together this community of young people in rural areas all over the hemisphere. I want to thank all of you. If there's anything else, we can talk to you later this afternoon. Yesterday afternoon, someone asked whether we can meet at 4 o'clock over Disco, and we can. And the mentors will be standing by, will be ready to work with you and support you with anything else you need to ask. And remember that your product needs to be turned in before Monday the 28th at midnight, Costa Rica time. I wish you all the greatest of success. Good luck with your work, and we'll see you again soon.